¿Mi es? ¿Qué se llama con mi es?
Good afternoon, dear parents, students, and fellow teachers.
Thank you for joining us today. It is wonderful to see each one of you.
I am Barbara.
I am Lani.
We welcome you to our kindergarten elementary Christmas service.
Our Christmas theme this year is the joy of Christmas. As the Bible tells us, the good news of Jesus' birth brings great joy for all the people. This everlasting joy remains with us today.
True, though we are still in the pandemic era, we still can feel the joy and the hope Christ brings to this world. Therefore, let us rejoice and celebrate the joyful news of Jesus' birth today.
We would like to open the service with a word of prayer. Our principal, Miss Jackie, will lead us in the opening prayer.
Hello everyone. Before we continue our program, let us all pray. Our Father in heaven, we are so grateful that you have granted us this day to celebrate your Son's birthday, Jesus. We are grateful for your love for us. You gave your only Son so we can be saved from our sins. Lord, as we celebrate this Christmas event, we dedicate to you our presentations. Be with us as we sing and dance and glorify your name. It is you and you alone why we are here. It is you why we feel great joy in our hearts. Thank you, dear Father, for everything. Thank you for giving Jesus to our lives. Thank you for loving us unconditionally. No words can express how much we adore you, Lord. This Christmas program is for you. Thank you, dear Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you, dear parents.
One day, an angel surprised a young woman named Mary. She was very scared. He said, "Don't be afraid, Mary. You will have a baby. You must name him Jesus. He will be a great king and his kingdom will last forever."
Mary bowed her head and thought about what the angel taught her. "I'll do whatever God wants," she said.
That night, Joseph had a dream too. An angel said to him, "You should take Mary as your wife. She will have a child, who is the Son of God. You are to name him Jesus. He will save people from God's punishment for all the bad things they have done."
Mary and Joseph will have a Nazareth waiting for the baby to be born.
Then the Roman rulers of the country make a new law. Everyone needs to go to their family's hometown to register their name for taxes.
Mary and Joseph have to go to a place called Bethlehem. By the time they arrive, it's getting dark, and Mary was about
to have a baby. They look for a safe place to sleep, but all in sorrowful.
Sleep in a stable.
Later that night, Jesus was born. Mary wrapped him warmly and laid him in a manger. In the fields outside Bethlehem, an angel stood in front of the shepherds who were watching over their sheep. The angel said, "Do not be afraid. Tonight, the Son of God was born in a stable in Bethlehem. You will find him lying in a manger." At once, the sky was filled with angels, singing glory to God in the highest and peace to those he loves. The shepherds rushed to Bethlehem to find Jesus. They soon found the stable and bowed down to worship Jesus. As they returned to their sheep, the shepherds told everyone the good news that the Son of God had been born in the stable that night.
Far away from Bethlehem, some wise men saw a new shining star in the night sky. They knew it was a sign from God that a new king had been born. So they began his long journey to find him, taking presents with them for the new king.
Wise man followed the star all the way to Bethlehem. When they came to the place where Jesus lay, the star came to stop. They went inside and knelt down beside Jesus. They gave him gold, incense, and a spice called myrrh.
Thank you, Miss Jackie, for leading us in prayer. And thank you, boys and girls, for the lovely performance.
Miss Barbara, This is the third year that we get to celebrate Christmas online. How do you feel?
Well, I feel sad and happy at the same time. Sad because we can celebrate Christmas on site, but then I also feel happy because God still gives us this precious moment when we can celebrate Christmas together virtually. What about you, Miss Lani?
I couldn't agree more. There are always things we can be grateful for. Our God is good.
True. And we are so grateful for God's love that He has sent His Son to earth to bring joy and hope to this world. Let us all stand up and start this service by singing Hark the Herald Angels Sing and Gloria in Excelsis Deo.
Peace on earth and mercy mild, God and sinners reconciled. Joyful all ye nations rise, join the triumph of the skies. Greetings in voice proclaim, Christ is born in Bethlehem. Hark the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King. Hail the heaven-born Prince of Peace, hail the Son of Righteousness. Light and life to all He brings, risen with healing in His wings. Mild He lays His glory by, born that we no more may die. Born to raise us from the earth, born to give a second birth. Hark, the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King. Hark, the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King. Angels we have heard on high, sweetly singing o'er the plains, and the mountains in reply, echoing their joyous strains. Gloria in excelsis Deo. Come to Bethlehem and see Him whose birth the angels sing.
Glory to God in the highest. Amen. Now, Miss Barbara, I heard that the students are also excited to praise the Lord.
Well, yes. They have been diligently practicing for this performance, Miss Lani. They want to give the best to God in this special moment. Let us welcome the lower choir performance.
What a wonderful performance by our grade 1 to 3 choir students.
Indeed, their voices are just amazing. God has given them such a great talent, and it is so wonderful that they can use it to worship God.
Now, we are going to prepare our hearts before we listen to the sermon. I invite all of us to sing Away in a Manger, and after that, we will listen to a sermon delivered by Pastor Brandon James Ingram.
Students and parents and teachers and staff, before we get into God's word, let us pray together. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for this day. We thank you for your wonderful love for us, that we can all be together, even though it's online. As Ms. Barbara and Ms. Bonnie said, we're so thankful that we can still celebrate together. And just pray, Lord, a blessing upon everybody, wherever they're at in their homes online, that you would speak to us now through your word. As we celebrate Christmas together, we want to reminisce upon the true meaning of Christmas. What is the joy of Christmas? Prepare our hearts and also protect us from any distractions in our home or wherever we're at, that we can focus on your word. Speak to us now, and we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, everybody, it's so great that we can be together to study the word together. It's so wonderful to see all the students. I see you all so excited to be here. And I know everybody's excited about the end of the semester. And what a blessing and a joy that we can spend this time together. So today we're going to look at a story about Christmas. And I want to invite you all to turn in your Bibles with me to Luke chapter 2. And I'm going to read for you all from verses 8 until 20. So I open up your Bibles with me and let us read together, okay? Luke chapter 2, verses 8 to 20. Now there were in watch over their flock by night. And behold, an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were greatly afraid. Then the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which will be to all people. For there is born to you this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. And this will be the sign to you. You will find a babe wrapped in swaddling cloths, lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of heavenly hosts, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men." So it was when the angels had gone away from them into heaven that the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go now to Bethlehem and see the thing that has come to pass, which the Lord has made known to us." And they came with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the babe lying in the manger. Now that when they had seen him, they made widely known the saying which was told them concerning this child. And all those who heard it marveled at those things which were told by them, by the shepherds. But Mary kept all these things and pondered them in her heart. Then the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things that they had heard and seen as it was told them. My friends, this is such a beautiful account, and it reminds us of, when Jesus came into the world, that this is what Christmas is all about. As we're studying this passage and talking together, I want you to think about, you know, what are the things that you are thankful for in your life, and what might be the meaning of the joy of Christmas to you personally. I remember growing up, I had so many wonderful memories during Christmas. As a kid, around your guys' age, all you students, it was the most exciting time of year. So every year in my city, there's a tradition, the fire truck and the firemen would dress up like Santa Claus and his elves, and they would go around on Christmas Eve with the siren on, and they would bring the presents to the houses of the kids that were brought there in the morning by the parents. And so me and my siblings would wait outside of our house, and the fire truck, it would get later into the evening. It would be dusk, you know, where it would start to get dark, and then it would get dark, and we'd be waiting for the fire truck to come with the sirens. And it was so exciting. And the fire truck would come, and then Santa would come into our house, a man dressed up like Santa from the fire department, and with his elves, men from the fire department dressed up like elves, and they would bring us presents. That was Christmas Eve. Now, Christmas Day, that was another story. We'd go to sleep that night. It's cold in my hometown. And so we were so excited. You know, we'd go to sleep, and the fire would be on in my house, and there'd be stockings hung by the fireplace. And my parents already wrapped many presents under the tree, decorated with lights. And so we'd go to sleep. And I remember I woke up the most early out of the whole year. I woke up the earliest on Christmas morning. And I wake up, it was still dark outside because I was so excited. And I came into my living room. I would come into my living room, my friends, and the living room would be filled with presents. And when I was young, my dad told me that it was, and mom told me that it was Santa Claus that brought it. But it was actually my parents that prepared it after we went to sleep. But it truly was the most exciting time of year, everybody, to have that time when we got all these presents. I remember I came to Indonesia, and Christmas became even more exciting because I knew Jesus, and I found the real meaning of Christmas, which is following God, experiencing his joy, and being with other believers in Indonesia, including all of you, the ICS family. And Christmas is in America celebrated twice a year, on Christmas Eve and Christmas Day. But in Indonesia, we celebrate it through the entire month of December. It's so exciting. And even though there's no snow here, and you sometimes sweat because it's so hot, but it's okay. It's such a joyful time. So I want to share with you from this passage the background of Christmas, the Christmas story, the original one. So what happened before the story about the shepherds is this. As the Bible says, if you go back in your Bibles in the first part of Luke chapter 2, it says, it came to pass in those days that a decree went out from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be registered. As was already mentioned in the performance by the lower graders, it was so incredible. So this one man in Rome thought he was so powerful, and he told everyone in the world that they had to be registered. So Joseph and Mary had to go from Nazareth to Bethlehem, and Mary was pregnant and very far into her pregnancy, everybody. And so it was a distance like from Jahapta to Bandung, but they didn't have cars or motorcycles. They had to go on a donkey. And what a interesting experience. And it's also very cold that time of year. And so they traveled down to Bethlehem. And that's where Jesus would be born. But it's interesting that the first announcement about the birth of Jesus went to who? As it says in verse 8 of our text today, it went to these shepherds that were out in the field watching over their flocks. Shepherds were interesting characters in the time of the Bible. Shepherds were considered to be unclean because they didn't follow the ceremonial laws because they were out in the fields for weeks at a time, watching over their flocks. And the shepherds were looked down upon by the people. They didn't think that they were too great of people. And these shepherds, lowly shepherds that were not considered great by the people in Israel, God revealed his son first to them through the angel. It's so amazing that they are watching over their sheep. And Jesus was born, who would become the lamb or the sheep of God, that would take away the sins of the world. And so an angel obviously appeared to them. An angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were greatly afraid. You know, sometimes we see angels as cute little like babies or cute little kids, you know, with the wings. But that's not the biblical angel. In the Bible, the angels, you know, are, when people see angels, they're terrified, you know. If you go back in the Old Testament, one angel could kill 185,000 Assyrian troops in one night. So they were powerful, terrifying beings, you know, when people would see them. But they were also, as it says in Hebrews, messengers. And they are God's servants to serve those who inherit salvation. That is you and I, my friends. And so this angel, we don't know who it was. It could be the angel Gabriel. We don't know, but we know one thing, that Gabriel couldn't keep a secret. There's a joke, because he always announced, you know, he announced the coming of the Messiah back in Daniel. And he also announced about the birth of John to Zacharias. So who knows? It could be Gabriel, but we don't know. It doesn't say in the Bible. And so he was, there was a commentator that made a story and said he was flying around and he saw a flicker of light. He had to announce this to somebody. He was so excited, and he saw a flicker of light out in the fields, and these shepherds were the only one awake. It's just a story that was made up, but either way, he announced it first to these shepherds, my friends, this exciting news about the birth of Jesus Christ. He said, "Fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy." What does good tidings mean? It means good news, great news to all peoples. The announcement came at nighttime, which also is a picture of the condition of man in the world, my friends. Life was difficult at that time throughout human history because of sin. In the Roman Empire, taxes were high, unemployment was high, morals were slipping lower, the military state was in control, and the Roman law, the Greek philosophy, and even Jewish religion could not meet the needs of the dark hearts of man. And man was filled with emptiness and struggling and as a slave of sin, with anger, bitterness, and hatred, and also sickness and famine, with no hope. And that's when, my friends, this great news came, the greatest news ever. That is a savior, the savior of mankind came into the world. He said, "For there is born to you in the city of David a savior who is Christ the Lord. What great news. Who is this baby that is born? It's predicted by the prophets that in Micah that Jesus would be born in Bethlehem. And Mary pondered these things in her heart. We're thinking about how God used the Roman Empire to bring them down there. And everything happened according to God's plan. And it wasn't a soldier, a judge, or a diplomat, but a savior. Because that is man's, that's you and your and my greatest need is a savior. Because we are sinners and we can't make it on our own. There's no arm, the strength of all the military in the world, all the money in the world, all the most brilliant technology cannot remove from you and I the smallest sin. But Jesus, our Savior, can have our sins washed away forever by his precious blood. And that's why he came. Jesus came, and there's a saying, this is the manger, you know, it's a feeding trough where they gave animals food. Imagine God of the God of the universe. He chose that his son would be born in a feeding trough for animals. If you were God, would you have your son born there, my friends? We would maybe have our son born in the best hospital, but God chose a feeding trough for his son because this is a picture of Jesus's mission. He didn't come to be a conquering king and live in luxury. He came to be a suffering servant, to suffer everything that you and I go through, and then ultimately to take on all of our sins, my friends. That's why he came. And there's a saying, this is the world's first king-size bed. This is where God had his son born. Jesus, the creator of the universe, the heavens and the earth, was born in this place, my friends. For God's glory dwelt in the tabernacle in the time of Moses until the time of Samuel. And then because of sin left, God's glory dwelt in the temple built by Solomon. And then because of sin left. And now God's glory comes and dwells in Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ himself is God. And then he came. And now we see the glory of God in Jesus Christ, who is the glory of God, my friends. And this Caesar, it's interesting because the Roman Caesar was to be called Savior or Lord, and they were supposed to worship him. And he brought peace. There's something called Pax Romana, which means the Roman peace. You know, it had been in effect since the year 27 BC before Christ. But the absence of war does not guarantee the presence of peace, my friends. Caesar was worshipped as Savior, but there's only one Savior and only one person can bring peace into our lives. That is the Prince of Peace, Jesus Christ. The emperor may give peace from war and land and sea, on land and sea, but he is unable to give peace from passion, grief, envy, sin, so to speak. He cannot give peace of heart for which man yearns more than even for outward peace, my friends. Only Jesus Christ. And today, this peace expresses the nature of salvation as the restoration of good relationship between good God and sinful man and the consequent reception of God's blessings, my friends. And that's why today the angel said, "Fear not, do not be afraid." My friends, I want to ask you, what are you afraid of today? There's many things to fear. There's war going on, and there's rumors of war going on. There's struggling and uncertainty in the economy. There's viruses and pandemics. There's rampant crime and wickedness throughout the world. There is a heavy decline in morality. All these things the Bible predicts, but it's still, we live in this world. For those of you parents with your children, it's scary. And for those of you that are kids and realize what's going on, it's scary for teachers and staff that are parents or worried about relatives. It's a scary time. But the Bible says to all of us to fear not. Did you know, my friends, that this statement is the most common statement that appears in the Bible? That God does not want us to fear, my friends. Maybe we're fearing because we're not trusting God. We need to connect more with him, my friends. Connect with Jesus, who's our peace. Jesus is our shalom. The word peace means much more than a truce in the battles of life. It means well-being, health, prosperity, security, soundness, and completeness. It has more to do with character than circumstances, my friends. This is the peace that Jesus brings. How big is God, my friends? When Jesus was born, you know, he's God in the flesh. How big are God's hands, you know? The Bible says that Jesus created everything in the world, my friends. He created the universe. But how big is his hand, you know? According to scientists, the universe is 93 billion light years across. Or if you go the speed of light, which is 300,000 kilometers per second, you will travel the entire galaxy in 93 billion years. But the Bible says that God stretched out the heavens with his hand. So all the universe is only as big and not even as big as God's hand, my friends. And that's the hand that is holding our lives together. That's the hand that came and was stretched out on the cross for you and I, my friends, to bring us peace with God. What a wonderful thing. Before we were enemies of God, and now we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. What a wonderful thing. And this peace we cannot find in this world. Even the richest people, the most famous people, they all say their riches and fame do not bring them inner peace. Because some of them obviously do not know Jesus Christ. This is the size of God's hand. Can God handle your problems, my friends? Can God handle every single problem that you will ever face the rest of your life? I think he can. What happens is that we do not see God in his glory, in his greatness. Take a 500 rupee coin outside in the sun and put it up very close to your eye. And don't look at the sun. It's dangerous. But for just a brief moment, if you take a coin and stick it right close to your eye, the sun can disappear. Imagine how big the sun is, but just a small coin can make the sun not disappear, but it blocks out the sun. And my friends, that's what happens with our problems, but God can handle them. He's more than capable. And not only that, he's in control of what we're going through. If God controls everything, even a Roman Caesar can't do anything except according to God's plan, my friends. Your and my lives are in God's plan today. Where we were born, where we grew up, what family you were a part of. It's all part of God's plan. And did you know that God loves us so much? And his plan is the best thing for us. And what he wants, what he asks from us, my friends, is that we just trust him. Can we do that, my friends, today? Just say, God, I'm sorry that I haven't trusted you. I'm going to trust you, Lord, because you're big. You're amazing and powerful. And forgive me for my disbelief. My faith is too small. Our logic sometimes can trick us, our feelings. Our brain is only 1 kilogram in weight compared to the God of the universe. And we think we know better than God. We dare to question God's love for us. We dare to question God's plan for us. No, 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 my friends. God is bigger. And he loves us. He doesn't condemn us. Just come to him today in your heart. And then we see, my friends, the response of this angelic host. If you look in verse 13 and 14, suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of heavenly hosts praising God and saying, glory to God in the highest and on earth, peace and goodwill toward men. It says a heavenly host. This is a military term. And according to Revelation 5:11, the multitudes of angels is innumerable. We can't count it, my friends. It's too many. And these heavenly hosts that are servants of the Lord that are being used by God according to his plan, bring glory to him and announce this. They break out together in song and say, glory to God in the highest. They're praising God for who he is and what he has done. They're intrigued that God has become a man, my friends, in wonder and amazement that the God of the universe stepped, you know, out of the heavens and came down to be a man like you and I in wonder and amazement. These angels praise God at creation, and now they're praising God at incarnation, which means when God came to be a man and to dwell among us. These angels were praising the Lord and said, glory to God in the highest and peace, goodwill toward men. What does this mean? This is the good news that's connected back to verse 10. And that's this. It means that God, that we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, and that his favor has rested upon us. God's favor is towards us. My friends, God loves you. God loves me. And God is not angry with us. We have peace with him through our Lord Jesus Christ. Whatever you might have done, my friends, as you come to him and ask for forgiveness, he will forgive you of all your sins, past, present, and future, and give you the absolute assurance of eternal life, my friends. That is good news, especially in light of the fact of how sinful we are. We are more sinful than we dare to imagine, but we are more loved and accepted than we could ever dare to hope. Don't let your mind trick you, my friends, into thinking that God doesn't love you. Yes, we're more sinful than we can imagine. We must admit that. But we're more loved and accepted than we could ever dare to hope through the love of Jesus Christ and his sacrifice on the cross. Now that's amazing. Another baby that was once born in Bethlehem grew up in the pastures of Bethlehem, hundreds of years before Jesus came. And this boy was named David, and he would sit out under the stars and be amazed at God. I think sometimes we need to turn off our gadgets, our laptops, our phone, and just go outside. Maybe you don't see the stars that well in Jakarta, but you can see the sky and look out into the sky at night and just ponder on, meditate on God's, how big God is and how much he loves us. David said, who am I? Who am I, God, that you would take notice of me? You're the God of the universe, but you love me? Somebody once said, the God of a trillion stars knows my name and he has a plan for me. And he knows, he loves me, what's best for me. Wow. Imagine that, my friend. Don't ever doubt his love. Spend time with him. Connect with him. Don't miss out on this greatest news ever of his wonderful grace, my friends, that baffles the angels, that Jesus came for you and I. He was crucified on a cross of wood, yet he made the hill on which it stood. What? He was crucified on the very hill that he himself made, Golgotha, my friends. Amazing news. And look, what did the shepherds do? They said, let's go and see. There was an urgency. We need to go and see. We heard this announcement from and saw this multitude of angels. And so they went to see with urgency, my friends. How serious are we about connecting with God, going to see him daily in our personal devotions when we read the Bible and pray? People are so excited about the World Cup. It's great. It's fun to watch the World Cup. But are we more excited about the World Cup than our relationship with God? Or is there something else in our lives that we prioritize more than our relationship with God, my friends? We must be careful. I used to love American football. And every Christmas, before I came to Christ, I was more excited about watching American football, okay? But I realized that that's not the joy of Christmas, because my life was empty, my friends, until I came to know Jesus as my Lord and Savior. It was the most wonderful moment and day of my entire life when I had the same, I believe, experience as the shepherds in my heart, where I truly experienced the joy and the fulfillment and the satisfaction and the peace receiving that good news, my friends, that Jesus loves me. And the love that I was yearning for and looking for my whole life that I didn't find in the world or anybody else, but I found it in Jesus, my friends. That's the answer. Jesus is the answer that you and I are looking for. And nothing else will satisfy our empty hearts. Not money and riches, not fame, not health, not a comfortable life, not everybody treating you well, not everything going well, it will never, ever satisfy your heart. There's a saying, there's an empty hole in the heart of man. That's the shape of the hole is God. Only God can fulfill that empty hole. And today, God wants us to experience his joy. My friends, I want to ask you, what are the most wonderful and joyous memories of your life? Mine are as I shared Christmas, but it didn't fulfill my heart. Mine are when I got married. I met somebody that worked at ICS, a teacher at ICS, and we fell in love and got married. And then we had our first daughter. Her name is Joy. I remember, as I told the students, when she first came out, her head looked like Bakso Salmon. Her name is Joy, and she brought us so much joy. I remember the first song she sung was this song, "Glory to God in the highest, glory to God, glory to God." And I remember, and before that, I remember the first word that she ever spoke. I'll never forget that, because we used to live in Kupang, and the first word she said was, "Bapa. Bapa," because that's the way that they say daddy in Kupang. And so the first word she said was Bapa, which was me, her daddy, but in the Kupangese language, my friends. And that brought me such great joy. It's wonderful joy for me to be with you all as part of the ICS family. And my friends, all of this is because of all the wonderful things in our lives is because of our relationship with God. That's the joy of Christmas, is to come to know his love, my friends. And look what the shepherds did. It says that they made it widely known, the saying, of all those things that they heard and were told by, you know, and everyone was amazed and marveled, it said. And then the shepherds returned glorifying and praising God of the things that they had seen and heard, my friends. God loves you. God loves everybody. He loves the shepherds that were the outcasts, the people that were looked down upon. He loves the people of Jakarta. He loves your family. And that's why Jesus came to die on the cross for you and I, my friends. But to what extent have we received his love into our lives? It's so important that as every Christmas gift, you must receive that gift. And this is a message that all of us need to hear, which is that the same message that the shepherds spoke, they proclaimed the good news, the birth of Jesus Christ. And every single person must make a decision in their life whether they will receive or reject Jesus Christ. Just because you claim to know the Lord or you do activities as what a believer does, it doesn't mean that you truly have a relationship with him. And I want to invite you all, you know, today is a wonderful day. The Bible says today is the day of salvation. And for all of you, if you're not sure if you've received Jesus as your Lord and Savior, I want to ask you to pray this prayer with me right now. Pray with your mouth from your heart. Say, "Lord Jesus, I know I'm a sinner. Forgive me of my sins. Wash me with your blood. Come into my heart and be my Lord and Savior. Give to me eternal life. In Jesus' name, amen." I'll pray for you now. Heavenly Father, we thank you for today. We thank you for your word that you've spoken to us. And God, as we've learned about the joy of Christmas, which is the good news of you, our Savior, Jesus, coming into the world, God, that we would truly receive you, the greatest gift of all. And that, God, that we would proclaim your love around wherever we're at, in our houses, in our to our relatives, to workers or coworkers, to staff, to friends in school, to even strangers as the Lord leads, that we would share, proclaim, as you lead us, this wonderful hope in Jesus Christ, the good news, the joy of Christmas. We thank you, God, for this time And we lift this up to you in Jesus' name. Amen. May the Lord richly bless and keep you all in his love and care.
Thank you for such a beautiful and encouraging sermon, Pastor Brandon. The sermon reminds us of God's love for us. I believe each one of us is blessed through God's word.
And now, let us prepare our hearts and take this precious moment to recall God's love and grace for us. We would like to invite Pastor Brandon to lead us in the candlelight service and prayer.
Dear friends, I want us to take this opportunity to collect the candles that we have and turn them on and get together with your families. And we're going to sing together with the worship team this song that they have prepared before our candlelight service. Friends, I want us to take this opportunity now together to be with our families. The days that we live in are very busy with many distractions. We obviously get distracted from our personal relationship with God, which is the most important thing in this world. The second is we sadly also get distracted from time with our families, our precious families that God has given us. There's nothing more important in this life than, besides our relationship with God, our relationship with others, especially our family. I want to ask everybody, wherever you're at, to get together with your families. For all of the students, I want you to be with your families there, all parents. I want you to come be with your children. I want everybody to sit down together with their candles lit. And with one hand, you can hold your candle. In the free hand, you can hold hands with your family members around you. And I want us to take this time and opportunity in the midst of our busy schedule, where we often neglect our family relationships that are the most important relationships in the world. I want us to take this time together to pray together. I don't know how often that you all have time to pray together, but I want you to pray together now. I want everyone to take this seriously, all you students. It's not a time to play with the candles. And I want you to pray together with your family. If you happen to be alone and with no other family members, I want you to take this time to pray for your family. But if you're with your family, I want you to pray together out loud right now, okay? So I'm going to give everybody some free time to pray for one another for a few minutes, okay? And now, everyone, let us bow our heads and close our eyes. All students, please close your eyes right now and bow your heads with me. And let us pray together. We're going to take a quiet time. Those that are with other family members, pray out loud and pray, take turns praying for one another. Whatever the Lord puts on your heart to pray. And for those of you that are alone before the screen, following this online service, I want you to pray for your family, wherever they're at, domestic, internationally, pray for them now, that the Lord would watch over them. That the light of the world, Jesus Christ, would shine upon them and strengthen them. And if you've had broken relationships in your family, I challenge you now to pray for those people that have hurt you from your own family. Pray that God would forgive them and the relationship would be restored. Please take this time, my dear parents, students, teachers, and staff. Heavenly Father, it's a wonderful joy that we can be together. Joy to this world is your Son, Jesus Christ, that you sent for all of us. And as we're together with our families or alone and praying for our families, we thank you for this special moment even though we're online, you are amongst us, as your word says, living in our hearts. I thank you for everyone that's joining right now. Thank you for their faithfulness in being here in this online service. Thank you for everything that they do in their lives that for you. And thank you for their lives, bringing them into this world, God. You love us so much and you have a plan for our lives. Nothing can happen outside of your will. Work sovereignly in everything for good. And God, as we're holding these candles lit, it reminds us that you, Lord Jesus, are the light of this world that came in and are shining in our dark heart, have shined in our dark hearts and lit our lives with your love and glory and warmth, God. And Lord, fill us with your Holy Spirit. Fill us with your love so we can love the people around us, even those that have hurt us, God. Restore relationships, God. Restore marriages. If anybody's had problems in their marriage, God, or is struggling, restore the hurts. Mend the broken hearts, because you said that you have come, Lord, to heal the brokenhearted and to restore the years that have been eaten up by the locust of sin and ravaged by sin. God, restore marriages of every parent of ICS that has struggled. Strengthen each family, each marriage to be a team, to bring up their children in the knowledge of Jesus Christ, so that every precious child in ICS that you've entrusted to the parents and the ICS family can be brought up to know Jesus as Lord and Savior and inherit eternal life and not follow this world system, leading them away from God. God bless every student. Thank you for them being here today. Thank you that you got them through this semester. Thank you for their hard work. Bless them, Lord, to have a wonderful break, to enjoy the time with their families. Protect them from danger, spiritual danger, distraction, or sin, anything they can access that would be sinful or lead them away from you, Lord. Guard them in your love, Jesus. For every teacher and staff and every leader, thank you, God, for all the ICS family that works so hard and gives their life, their time and their effort and heart to be a blessing, to teach the students, to lead the school, to take care of the school. Bless them, Lord. Bless their families with an awareness of your love, a protection, a peace, a joy. Restore any hurts in marriages or family, in relationships, God. May the light of the love of Jesus Christ shine upon this school and every individual that's connected and every family, God. We thank you. We surrender our lives. We surrender this time to you. And we thank you that we can have this candlelight service and remember your wonderful love that you came into this world to die on the cross for all of us. Thank you for this time. And thank you for everyone that's worked so hard to prepare this online Christmas service. And we pray that you bless the rest of this time. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you all.
Thank you, Pastor Brandon. Christmas is the season to celebrate God's love, joy, and peace. Now, let us welcome grade 4 to 6 choir students' performance.
Thank you. involved. There was a census headed up the entire Roman world. Everyone went to his own city to register.
So Joseph went up to Bethlehem, the city of David. He went there with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child.
While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son.
She wrapped him in cloth and placed him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn.
And there were shepherds out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks by night.
Suddenly an angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone upon them, and they were afraid.
Fear not, I bring you good news, a great joy that will be for all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior.
Praise the Lord!
Thank you, boys and girls. What an awesome performance.
We have come to the end of the service. And before we close the service with a word of prayer, I would like to encourage all parents to stay in this link for the announcement and welcome remarks that will be shared after the prayer and benediction.
We would like to invite Pastor Brandon to lead us in the closing prayer and benediction.
Let us pray together, my friends.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
Heavenly Father, I just want to thank you for this wonderful online Christmas service. Thank you so much for every parent, student, teacher, staff, and leader here. We thank you for your wonderful love for us, that we can celebrate together the joy of Christmas, which is Jesus Christ coming into this world for us as sinners who do not deserve. It's only by your grace, Father. Thank you for this time, God. And I just want to pray for a blessing upon everybody here, and that you would just be with them and strengthen them with your love and care and presence. Renew them all in their hearts, in their relationship with you, God. Restore and strengthen lives, and that we would make an eternal impact in our lives, that we would focus on what matters for eternity, Lord, and that we would get our eyes off fleshly things that will burn and will not last, Father God. Help us to truly focus on what really matters, our personal relationship with you, God, and also loving and caring for and being a blessing to other people that also need your love in our homes, in our families, in our school, in our workplace, wherever we might go, we can be a channel of your love and blessing. Dear friends and beloved of the Lord, turn your hearts to the Lord and receive his blessing. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and salvation in him, and may the love of our Heavenly Father that never passes away, and may the comfort and peace and presence of God, the Holy Spirit, be with you all in this Christmas season and also forever. Amen. God bless you all.
Hello, our blessed parents and students. It's really good to see you. I was very excited today watching all the beautiful performances you did. You know that God is pleased when you serve Him wholeheartedly and joyfully. I hope and pray that your beautiful performances will be blessings to whoever watching them. The joy of Christmas is our theme today, but remember, the joy of Christmas is not about the gifts. It's not about new clothes. It's about Jesus Himself who has born in our hearts. He is the joy of our Christmas. Now, will you share Jesus Christ, the joy of Christmas, to your brothers and sisters, mommy and daddy, grandmas and grandpas, cousins and friends? Yes, I know you will. I'm also very proud of you for having finished the first semester of this school year. You have learned a lot of new things. You have made a lot of new friends. But remember, next semester, there will be other adventures. You always remember to be brave and be kind. Be creative and be honest. Be humble and be thankful. Parents, thank you so much for celebrating this Christmas together with us. Your participation is greatly appreciated. Now, parents and children, on behalf of all teachers and staff of ISES, I'd like to wish you a very Merry Christmas. Have a very joyful holiday, and God bless you all.
Shalom, Bapak Ibu, orang tua, murid kindergarten dan elementary ISES yang saya hormati. Shalom anak-anak dan Bapak Ibu guru yang saya kasihi. Selamat Natal untuk Bapak Ibu dan anak-anak sekalian. Tidak terasa kita sudah di penghujung tahun 2022. Saya percaya ketika kita memasuki tahun 2022, kita memasukinya dengan ada rasa gentar dan kekhawatiran karena pandemi COVID yang belum berlalu. Pandemi ini memberikan ancaman bagi kesehatan kita atau mungkin juga bagi kondisi perekonomian kita. Tetapi hari ini ketika kita boleh ada di penghujung tahun 2022, kita boleh merasakan dan mempercayai bahwa semua ini adalah karena anugerah dan penyertaan Tuhan bagi kita. Bahkan sebentar lagi kita akan memasuki tahun 2023, semata-mata semua itu karena anugerah dan kasih setia Tuhan. Tapi Bapak Ibu, mungkin sebagian dari kita hari-hari ini masih ada dalam pergumulan karena dampak dari pandemi COVID ini. Tetapi walaupun demikian, kalau saat ini kita boleh ada dan merayakan Natal bersama-sama, dan kita masih punya sedikit kekuatan, masih punya sedikit kemampuan, bahkan masih punya sedikit pengharapan, maka itu menjadi satu tanda bahwa Tuhan kita Yesus Kristus adalah benar Sang Immanuel yang lahir di hari Natal itu. Dia Tuhan yang menyertai kita. Tuhan menyertai kita, tapi bukan hanya menyertai kita. Ketika dia datang, dia juga memberikan sukacita bagi setiap kita. Itulah tema Natal kita tahun ini. The joy of Christmas. Kristus datang membawa sukacita bagi setiap kita dalam setiap kondisi yang sedang kita hadapi. Seperti halnya ketika dia datang, malaikat berkata pada para gembala yang dalam pergumulan pada waktu itu untuk dapat merasakan sukacita besar yang dibawa Kristus. Bapak Ibu, biarlah sukacita itu terus memenuhi hati dan pikiran kita, membawa kita memiliki semangat yang baru memasuki tahun 2023. Biarlah sukacita itu juga mengalir dalam kehidupan kita. Tapi saya berharap bukan hanya mengalir dalam kehidupan kita, tapi juga terpancar keluar, sehingga kita juga bisa berbagi sukacita karena Kristus itu kepada orang-orang yang membutuhkan di sekeliling kita. Sekali lagi, selamat Natal tahun 2022 dan selamat menyambut tahun baru 2023. Tuhan Yesus memberkati kita semua.
Dear parents and students, There are several announcements for the end of this first semester. Let's take a look. On December, start from 5 to 9 of December is the special schedule for kindergarten students. And then kindergarten students' Christmas holiday will be start from 12 December until 6 January 2022. The next one. Not yet. Go back to the last slide. Okay. Start from the 15th of December until start from the 5 until 14 December is the special schedule for elementary students. And then elementary students' Christmas holiday will be start from 15 December until 6 January 2022. Then on-site report card distribution for kindergarten and elementary will be held on December 17. And the kindergarten and elementary student resume will be at 9 of January. The last but not least, please fill in the attendance form, by scanning this barcode, or you can, you may click at the link in the chat box. Okay, these are the announcements. Thank you, parents, our beloved students, and all fellow teachers for joining us till the end of this service. Now, you may give your best smile to the person next to you and say, Merry Christmas. As we close this Christmas service, we are going to sing Feliz Navidad.
Feliz Navidad, Feliz Navidad, Feliz Navidad, Prospero Año y Felicidad. Feliz Navidad, Feliz Navidad, Feliz Navidad, Prospero Año y Felicidad. Christmas from the bottom of my heart. I wanna wish you a Merry Christmas. I wanna wish you a Merry Christmas. I wanna wish you a Merry Christmas from the bottom of my heart. Feliz Navidad. Feliz Navidad. Feliz Navidad. Prospero año y felicidad. Feliz Navidad. Feliz Navidad. Feliz Navidad. Prospero año y felicidad. I wanna wish you a Merry Christmas. I wanna wish you a Merry Christmas. I wanna wish you a Merry Christmas from the bottom of my heart. I wanna wish you a Merry Christmas. I wanna wish you a Merry Christmas. I wanna wish you a Merry Christmas from the bottom of my heart. I wanna wish you a Merry Christmas from the bottom of my heart.
Thank you, everyone.